You stand on the shore of the ocean watching the tide come in. You sense the call of the sea beckoning to take you in further. You step forward little by little, not knowing what to expect, but expecting more. You keep going as the ocean calls you to enter in to deeper waters.
Hello everyone, I am Peters. Welcome back to Deeper Waters Podcast for another exciting installment. This month, of course, is the month of Roe v. Wade. And that means abortion is going to be on people's minds some, and I'm going to equip you with the very best that I can. And to do that, I decided to bring in an up-and-coming apologist from the Life Training Institute, and that is my friend Clinton Wilcox, who is joining us now. Clinton, are you there?
Yes, I am here.
Okay. Well, my audience might not know much about you, so tell us about who you are and how you got to where you are today. What's the Clinton Wilcox story?
Okay. Well, I currently reside in Fresno, California. The way that I first got involved in the pro-life movement was that when I was in college, I took a public speaking class, and one of our speeches had to be on a controversial topic, and it had to be presented in such a way that you couldn't let on which position you held. So it basically had to be a balanced speech. And so I just kind of chose the topic of abortion out of thin air. And as I was researching the topic, I started actually, I'd always been pro-life because I was a Christian, but I'd never really looked into the issue deeply until I had to take that public speaking class and had to research the topic. And so in my research, I started, I actually learned about what the procedure of abortion is and the frequency that it's performed. It wasn't the graphic pictures that it did for me, although I do believe that there's great value in showing those pictures, and I've seen people convinced by the images. But it was really the information that I learned that not only solidified my pro-life stance, but also kind of lit the fire in me to want to stop this procedure, because I've learned that that unborn children in America are being killed to the tune of about 3,300 every day. That's about 1.2 million every year. And so that was just a mind-blowingly staggering number of unborn children that are legally killed in America. And that was what kind of lit the fire in me to want to oppose this procedure and get more involved in the pro-life field.
So tell us about the Life Training Institute right quick, Ben, and how did you get involved with it?
Okay, well, Life Training Institute is an organization that's run by Scott Klusendorf, and it has pro-life apologists all over the United States and parts of Canada. Their mission is to speak to high school and I believe college students as well to winsomely spread the pro-life message and equip pro-life people in how to spread the message both persuasively by using good arguments and effectively by having good conversations with people, that kind of thing. And so so I first got noticed by Scott because I'd been blogging. I have a personal blog, but I also have been submitting articles to an organization called Secular Pro-Life, and through them they've been some of my articles have been picked up by other sites like lifenews.com, and I just started getting noticed by Scott, and one day just kind of out of the blue, Scott sends me a message over Facebook and kind of asks what my aspirations are as a pro-life advocate and what I'm currently doing in that regard, and it just kind of took off from there that Scott wanted to bring me into the organization.
You know, I think it's very important you mention the Secular Pro-Life group, because it is a Christian podcast, as my listeners know, but while our position is held by a number of Christians, you know, unfortunately not all of them, but
right.
This is also a position that is not one that you have to be a Christian to recognize. This is part of general revelation, and you can be a secularist and consistently be pro-life, right?
Oh, right. Yeah, absolutely. In fact, Christian philosophy has been going back for, 2,000 years, ever since the church basically started. And so Christianity has a long and proud tradition of not just using scripture, but also using general revelation, arguing from just general facts about the world that appeal to intuitions that even non-Christians share to make their case. And the pro-life case is no different. I know many atheists and agnostics who are pro-life. And so while I believe a very strong case can be made for the pro-life position using the scriptures, I also believe that a very compelling case can be made for the pro-life position apart from the scriptures, just by arguing from science and general philosophy. And so that's basically what I do. If I'm talking to Christians, I'll use the Christian arguments, but if I'm talking to someone who doesn't accept the scriptures as an authority, then I will use a secular case to make the position.
And this is something important for us to establish, because we'll usually be told that what we're doing is we're trying to turn America into a theocracy here and forcing a Christian viewpoint on people, but we're not trying to force a Christian viewpoint, we're trying to push a moral viewpoint that just happens to be consistent with Christianity.
Well, right. In fact, as I've heard Scott Klusendorf say in the course of a debate, you and the government don't have to take a position on the soul in order to make killing human beings illegal. So it's not a big leap at all to go from it's wrong to kill you and me because we're human beings. The unborn are human beings, therefore it's wrong to kill them too. You don't have to take a position on the soul or any metaphysical position in order to see that certain actions like abortion and murdering of older human beings is wrong.
Mm-hmm. In fact, you could entirely be a Christian physicalist or a materialist and still take that position.
Right.
Now, since you mentioned debate, I think it's also worth pointing out you actually did a debate on the Razor Swift podcast, I guess, or about a year and a half ago or so, didn't you?
I think it was about a year ago. I think it was last January that we did the debate. So yeah, it's been about a year. About a year and a half ago, so about a half year before that, I was on Razor Swift again, just making the general case for the pro-life position.
Well, for anyone who hasn't heard that debate, I think it was an excellent debate. I think your case was incredibly compelling, and I do encourage people to go through the archives of Blog Talk Radio, find the Razor Swift podcast, and listen to that debate.
Thank you.
So now, you talked also about 3,300 people, children, being killed every day in abortion.
Right.
Yeah. I've heard the comparisons that about 3,000 to 4,000 people, in on estimate, were killed in 9/11. So that means
Right. We're
killing about as many every day as 9/11 killed in one day.
Right. Yeah. It's a pretty staggering statistic.
Mm-hmm. So how exactly did we get to this position? I mean, the law changed in 1973, if my history is correct. So how exactly did we get to Roe v. Wade?
It was pretty much a concerted effort by pro-abortion organizations. And real quick, I just want to make mention, when I talk about a general pro-choice person, I will use the term pro-choice because that's the term they prefer to use, and I don't want to be inflammatory. But there are certain organizations which I would say are clearly pro-abortion, and the organization NORAL is definitely one of those. Bernard Nathanson, who was the founder of NORAL and past president of the organization, essentially wanted to get abortion legalized in the United States, and he wrote a book called Aborting America later, after he became pro-life, in which he kind of recounted the whole battle leading up to Roe v. Wade. And so they resorted to certain tactics like they inflated numbers about the number of women that were being killed. They they basically made this a religious issue, saying that the only people who would oppose abortion are you know, religious fanatics, like the higher-ups in the Catholic Church are the only ones who want abortion to stay illegal. And so they were making it a religious issue as well. And then they were also making it a feminist issue, where they were trying to recruit female groups, trying to convince them that in order to truly be free and be equal with men, that we needed to legalize abortion, which completely flied in the face of the original feminism, where they were trying to get the right to vote and to hold property. And the feminists back then actually believed that abortion is the ultimate exploitation of women, and that it's very wrong, considering that women were once treated as property, to treat children as property to be disposed of as they saw fit. So they basically made it a religious and a feminist issue. When in reality it really wasn't. But these things were convincing to the general public, and they eventually rallied enough support that they managed to get Roe v. Wade passed.
And it's important, though, when we say that they got Roe v. Wade passed, that it wasn't through a general vote, though.
No, I don't believe it was.
Okay. Now, you talked about the number of women killed. Now, some of my listeners have been thinking, well, I'm sure women are killed in abortion, but so are men, I mean, there are babies. But that's not what you're talking about exactly, is it, when they start talking about women being killed, right?
Well, right, yeah. When they talk about that they want abortion to be safe, legal, and rare, obviously the safe doesn't have anything to do with the unborn child, because every successful abortion results in the child's death. They say that in order for abortion to be truly safe, we need it to be legal and regulated, and that's how the argument goes. And of course, now that abortion is legal, it's still not regulated, because you still have guys like Kermit Gosnell who are allowed to operate without, you know, the police breathing down their neck. And in fact, the numbers that they inflated before Roe v. Wade was they were saying that there were some 5,000 to 10,000 women every year being killed by illegal abortions, which was just completely false. In fact, in 1972, the year before Roe v. Wade, only 39 women died from illegal abortion. And of course, that's still 39 women too many. We don't like any women to die. But it's certainly not in the area of the numbers that were being put forth in the courts to try to rally public support for this.
This is also including women who were supposedly, like 7,500 to 10,000 of them, were trying their own abortions in back alleys with coat hangers. Mm-hmm. And we're often told today that if we repeal abortion laws and we have it illegal again, that we're going to see that many women die in back alleys of coat hangers.
Right, and it's just not true. First of all, what made abortion safe is not legalizing it, because again, only 39 women died in 1972 before Roe v. Wade. What made abortion safer is the advancement in medical technology, which means that if we're to make abortion illegal again and push it back underground, first of all, no one is being forced to die, because you know, no one is going to be forcing women to go to these clinics to get illegal abortions. So arguing that making abortion illegal will lead to unsafe abortions again, well, that's just a spurious argument, because no one is going to be forcing them to get those abortions. I mean, you might as well argue that we should make bank robbery legal to make it safer for the bank robber. If something is immoral, then it should be, immoral to the point where it should be illegal, then the fact that it's dangerous to do it illegally is not an argument for making it legal. And then there are just, if it is made illegal again, there are other ways that women can have abortions that would be safer for the woman than really coat hangers. I really don't think anyone's going to be resorting to coat hangers if it's driven underground again.
It's important that you brought out a distinction between immoral and illegal, because just because something is illegal doesn't mean it's immoral, and just because something is legal doesn't mean it is moral.
Right. Yeah, so that's an important distinction to make, too, because we're not just arguing that abortion is immoral. We're arguing that it's the kind of immoral act that we should make illegal.
Now, and there are certainly acts that as Christians, we think are immoral, but we're not ready to push legislation for instance, I consider adultery to be immoral, but we don't want the government policing every marriage's bedroom, for instance.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Now, you also talked about how the original feminist saw this as an exploitation of women, and modern feminists see this as allowing themselves to be true women. How is it that the earlier feminists saw this as exploitation, and the later feminists saw this as allowing them to be true women?
Yeah, I'm not an expert on feminism, but I'm just going to pretty much tell you how I see it currently. It's that the original feminists embraced woman-like abilities. Like they embraced the fact that women were the ones that essentially create life and allow it to develop within themselves for 9 months and then give birth to it and raise it. They embrace that, whereas modern feminists tend to shy away from that. And that's, I think it partially has to do also with the over-sexualization of our culture. Like we've kind of gotten away from the idea that sex leads to pregnancy and that sex should remain within the bounds of marriage because that gives children a stable relationship in which to grow. And it basically encourages the parents to form a family unit. And now our society has kind of gotten this idea where sex and its procreative element can be divorced. So now you can have recreative sex apart from children, and you can have contraceptives. If your contraceptives fail, just go have an abortion. So now women kind of have this idea that they need abortion to be equal with men, because men can go have sex with women and then basically walk away. But women, if they want to have recreative sex, well, of course, they're the ones who get pregnant. So with this idea that sex is recreative and not procreative, now they want abortion to be legal so that they can have equal chances that men do, so that they can not have to be tied down to a pregnancy if they want to have recreative sex. Because with pregnancy, comes other things like their body changes. They might affect certain aspects of their work life and things like that. And so they kind of feel now that they need it to kind of be on equal footing with men.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it just seems so amazing to me that women are scared of being treated like objects. And nothing is really going to enable that as much as saying, hey guys, you can have sex with us and don't worry about the consequences. We'll take care of those.
Right. Yeah, and so, well, I mean, it's true that abortion does, it doesn't really help women as much as they feel it does, because it actually benefits deadbeat men who want to use women for sex and then, just take them in, have an abortion, have the act erased, and they can just go about their business. So, so I think it hinders women in a lot of ways more than it would help them.
Well, we're going to take a quick break right now. I'm Nick Peters of the Deeper Waters Podcast. My guest is Clinton Wilcox, staff apologist at the Life Training Institute, and we'll be back after this break.
Join Unituber and Army Girl for Christ as they discuss spiritual warfare, spiritual preparedness, the end times, life issues, and personal and spiritual growth. That's www.truthradionet.com. Truthradionet.com.
I can't believe the news today. Oh, I can't close my eyes and make it go.
And we're back to the Deeper Waters Podcast. My guest is Clinton Wilcox talking about abortion. I think it was last July that I spent a couple of hours one episode on here. My guest couldn't make it, and I talked about a case that brings out what we're talking about with the abortion laws being strengthened in Texas, right? It'd be harder, and one guy who was extremely honest wrote about it, talking about why men should come out and oppose this, should allow abortion more, and his final point that I made, and everyone jumped on this, rightly so, and was being spread all over Facebook and such social media. The final point he made is, gentlemen, your sex life is at stake. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do remember that. Is that the whole bro choice thing that you're talking about?
It could be. I don't remember if there was a tie around, but I was remembering, yeah, now it's so good that someone revealed what's behind the curtain. So you can give a message out that, see, guys, if this passes, we can't use women. We actually have to be responsible to them, make covenants with them, you know, what some people call marriage, and be responsible for any children that come about.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I think that's part of being a man, is taking responsibility for your actions. And, yeah, he had really ridiculous reasons. I don't remember what they were, because it's been a while since I've read the article. But it was something, you know, one of his reasons was, you know, if she's worried about getting pregnant, then sex isn't going to be as enjoyable for you and things like that. Yeah, it was pretty horrible.
Yeah. Now, let's get into the pro-life thing itself, but before we do that, we need to know what we're arguing for. You were talking about, you found out what really happens in abortion, where most of us are probably thinking, well, when a woman gets an abortion, she goes in there, she's got pregnancy, it gets terminated somehow, and she comes out okay, and life goes on. But let's clarify the game. What really happens in abortion? What did you find out that was so stunning?
Well, like I said, I've always been pro-life my entire life, but it was the numbers that moved me to action, because I realized that that some 1.21 now, I think it was a little higher in the past, like maybe 1.4, but yeah, so many unborn children were being killed, and that's really what moved me to action. So it's really the numbers that motivated me, and so I don't know, you know, how graphic you want to get, but the abortion procedures, when a woman goes in for one, they tend to be pretty awful. I mean, we treat convicted murderers on death row better than we do the unborn. It's pretty gruesome.
Well, I can give a little heads up, and I will be giving this again after our third break, that for the more medical aspects of what's going on, my guest next week is going to be Dr. Frieda Busch, and she works with Dr. Jennifer Roback's Morse's agency, and she's going to be talking about the medical aspects of abortion. But it is something horrible, since you said that convicts on death row are treated better.
Right. Yeah, I mean, whatever you think of capital punishment, I mean, when they're put to death, they're done, you know, in a painless method, you know, the whole humane treatment, they're not even offered that, because from what I understand, often the unborn child isn't even given anesthesia before the abortion.
Now, I'd also like to, before I forget again, remind people, if you want to call in with a question, and Clinton knows I was using, in fact, looking forward to some of them, the call-in number is 714-242-5180, 714-242-5180. Be glad to take your questions. And while we have said that we're not really going to go into scripture here, if you do have a question that is related to scripture and abortion, we will happily take it.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, let's get started though with this case though. If you're going to be talking with someone and you're going to try and convince them that they should be pro-life, how are you going to go about doing it?
Okay, well, the first thing I would do is talk about the scientific argument for abortion. Greg Kokel of Standard Reason says that if the unborn are not valuable human beings, then no justification for abortion is necessary. You know, if it's, you know, it's just like having a mole removed or a teeth pulled. But if the unborn is a valuable human being, then no justification for abortion is adequate. And so Greg likes to illustrate this by saying, for example, suppose you're washing dishes and your, you know, 3 or 4 year old child comes up to you, taps you on the shoulder, and says, "Mommy or Daddy, can I kill this?" Well, your back is turned, so what's your first question going to be? what is it? You know, if it's a cockroach, you know, yes, son, go have fun. Don't tell your mother. If it's the neighbor kitty, hold on, son. Old man Kenobi next door is not going to appreciate that. If he's got his kid brother by the neck, then we're probably going to recommend some counseling. So whether you can kill something depends on what that thing is. So the central question of the abortion issue is, what is the unborn, which is where we need to start. So we know from science that human life begins at fertilization. First, we know that they're alive. They exhibit the properties of living things. They metabolize food for energy. They respond to stimuli. And they grow through cellular reproduction. So we know that they're alive. We know that they're human because they have human DNA. They're also the product of human parents. Dogs produce dogs. Cats produce cats. And humans produce human offspring. So we know that they're alive, and we know that they're humans, but we also know that they're organisms, that they are a whole complete organism with their own functional parts on a self-directed path of development, developing themselves from within into a more mature version of themselves. So we know from the science of embryology that the unborn are living human organisms. In fact, the embryology textbooks affirm this as well. For example, Ronan O'Reilly and Fabiola Mueller, in the most used embryology textbook, from what I understand it's the most used, they say that although life is a continuous process, fertilization, which incidentally is not a moment, is a critical landmark because under ordinary circumstances, a new genetically distinct human organism is formed when the chromosomes of the male and female pronuclei blend in the oocyte. And it's not just them, but we have many accounts of embryologists who are all in agreement, pro-life, pro-choice embryologists. They all agree that human life, and in fact, life of any living thing, but human life begins at fertilization. So biologically, we know that they're one of us. And so I start from there. And so my first argument is essentially that we know that you and I are human beings, members of the human species. If it's wrong to kill you and me because we're human beings, and the unborn are human beings like you and me, then abortion is likewise wrong because it kills innocent human beings. And so that's where I make my starting point.
Okay, well, let's discuss this starting point some, because then one of my concerns is when I've talked with people who are supporting abortion, it honestly gets me very angry, and there are a few things that do that, but part of it is this callousness that I seem to see about the nature of life. And some of them will even say, well, you might think it's an important question to decide if the unborn is a human or not, but for me the most important thing to think about is the freedom of a woman. Now, what would you say to someone like that?
Okay. Right. And so, so the central question determines that this is a human life. But some people, they'll take other arguments for abortion and try to argue from that position. And so, let's just assume that the unborn is a human being, that it's valuable, has a right to life. But would the woman have the right to kill it anyway? And some people try to argue from bodily rights. Did you have like a specific argument that you were wanting to talk about, or?
No, just a general. What if someone says, I think the good of the freedom of a woman ranks above the question of if this is a life?
Okay. If someone were to say that, I would probably respond by saying, so let's just imagine instead of a pregnant woman, let's just imagine that a woman gives birth, the child is now 2 years old. This is actually a technique that Scott Klusendorf and Greg Kokel have deemed tried out the toddler. For a situation similar to this, let's imagine it's not a human fetus in the womb, but it's a toddler now. So you're arguing that the freedom of the woman should take precedence over the fetus in her womb, or the embryo. So let's imagine now that you have a 2-year-old child in front of you that the woman gave birth to. Do you believe that she should have the right to kill that child? Should her freedom as a parent override that child's right to life? And of course, the answer would be no. And then you would ask, well, why not? Well, it's because they're human. And so we're right back to the beginning. Okay, so that seems to be the question. If the child is a human being, then it seems like we can't justify killing the child just to allow the woman to exercise her freedom.
Let's suppose that somebody up there did, and so that they could, because hypothetically, I mean, Peter Singer and others that give a time of, I think, 4 weeks after a child is born that a parent may kill a child.
Okay. If they were a singer, right, I would probably ask them if that's really their position, or if they're, you know, maybe if they're just trying to save their position, because you're from what I gather, because you know I talk to a lot of college students, and you're not very likely to meet very many singerites, except maybe on the internet, but you meet a lot of interesting individuals on the internet. If you'd like to address it now, we can, but I was actually going to address an argument like that a little bit later as we talk about the pro-life case. So would you like to save it for later, or would you like to go ahead and go over it now? All right, you still with me?
Oh, yeah, let's go ahead and cover it now, and then later on you can bring out anything about it you think is important.
Okay. So in that case, I would probably ask them what it is that they believe makes us valuable. Because they can bring up Singer, but the problem is that really doesn't tell me anything. Because there are several philosophers who try and tell us that we can kill infants because they're relevantly different from us, and the unborn share that relevant difference. So it's okay to kill them. So my first question would be: okay, so what's the relevant property that you believe makes one valuable that the infants would lack that would justify killing them? So did you have one that you wanted to throw out, or?
Well, I would think of Adam. Maybe what we could use is something like, say, sentience or rationality, okay, for instance.
Okay, right. Okay, so, yeah, so the infant is definitely, doesn't exhibit sentience like we do. There are some philosophers who believe that we're not actually self-aware until sometime after our first birthday. You know, they talk about the mirror test, like you put the child in front of a mirror, and if they can recognize themselves in the mirror, then we know that they're aware of themselves, and that's not just a, you know, similar-looking child. So my question then, if someone brings up rationality, is there like a particular threshold of rationality they have to cross, or do they just do they just have to exhibit any rationality? Because really, if you're talking about a function that we must exhibit in order to be valuable, then that seems to lead to what some philosophers call the episodic problem. Whereas, if, for example, if rationality is the relevant feature, then you would cease to be a person every time you cease being rational. So like when you fall asleep or enter a reversible coma, or if you go under general anesthesia for surgery, you would cease to be a person, which means that if we can justify killing the infant for that reason, we can also justify killing someone who's asleep or in a coma or under general anesthesia. And so I really don't think they want to run into the episodic problem. So it really seems like trying to base, you know, personhood or value on a function leads to problems that would cause us to disqualify certain uncontroversial persons, essentially.
And we can also add in that there are, in fact, degrees of rationality. Some people are smarter than other people are, but that wouldn't mean that people who are smarter than others have more of a right to live than their less intelligent friends.
Right. Yeah, and so that's also why it's kind of important to ask if they believe any rationality is important, or if there's like a certain threshold that you have to cross, because it is a, I'll have a name for it, a degree property. And so it seems to me, I believe Frank Beckwith argues this, that that personhood is not something that comes in degrees. You either have it or you don't. So it can't be tied to a property that comes in degrees, like rationality, like you were saying. So I think that's definitely an important point, too.
Yeah, something else we can bring up in all these answers about protecting life at start is that someone say, well, okay, Clinton, you don't think we should kill an innocent human being and such. Okay, but do you ever, for instance, go out and get fast food where you've killed animals, in fact, just for your own personal pleasure? Why should the life of a human rank differently from the life of an animal?
Okay. Yeah, this is probably where Peter Singer would go. He talks about how if we're going to argue that human beings are valuable to where we can't kill them, but animals are not, then he calls this the speciesist problem. And he says that speciesism is as wrong as sexism or racism, because you are basically choosing an arbitrary property to base value on. Now, I think that this is a mistaken claim, because I think that it's not being human that makes us valuable, but I think it's what being human entails. As a Christian, I believe that we're made in the image of God, and I think that bestows our value. But avoiding religious arguments, I think what makes us valuable is the fact that we are rational agents, that we have the ability to determine right from wrong and act accordingly. We have the ability to basically go past our limits. You know, we've sent people to the moon. We can paint the Rembrandt or the Sistine Chapel. You know, we can build these huge this huge architecture, which is just light years ahead of what animals can do. And so I think it's that rational nature that makes us valuable, and it's that rational nature that bestows on us rights and obligations, because animals don't have any obligations to us because they're not rational beings. They can't, they can't know what's rational or act accordingly, but we can. So that gives us certain obligations to treat certain things in certain ways. And I believe it's that rational nature that makes us valuable. And in fact, Christopher Kaczor, in his book, The Ethics of Abortion, actually gives a little bit of a thought experiment to show that that humans are on a higher plane than animals. And just as an aside, this doesn't mean that animals are not valuable. One can consistently hold that animals are rights-bearing entities, in fact, that they're as valuable as human beings, and still be pro-life. I don't necessarily hold that view, but Kaczor gives the following illustration. There are three ways we can see that belonging to the human species has special value. The first example is someone is driving and hits a squirrel and does a hit and run on that squirrel, and then someone does a hit and run on a human child. Well, the person who did a hit and run on the human child deserves to go to jail. The person who did a hit and run on the squirrel doesn't. The second illustration is eating a hamburger is a lot different than eating a Harold burger, even if Harold was functionally no more intelligent than a cow. There's still a big difference between eating a human being and eating a cow. And the third illustration is bestiality, that it's wrong for humans and other species to procreate, even though, you know, for example, it'd be wrong for a human to have sex with a horse, even though it's not wrong for two horses to get together. But it would be wrong for a human being to do that with an animal, even if that human being was functionally no more intelligent than that animal. And so I think those three illustrations really show that we have very strong intuition that there is something different about human beings than about the lower animals. And so it seems to me that speciesism is not really on par with sexism or racism, because in sexism or racism, you're focusing on a literal surface difference while you're, you know, the gender of the person or the race of the person, but ignoring what we all have in common that makes us equally valuable, and that's our human nature, our common human nature.
Okay, well, we're going to take our second break. We've got some more questions I'd like to ask. And we'll be back after this break. My guest is Clinton Wilcox of the Life Training Institute. I'm Nick Peters. This is the Deeper Waters Podcast. We'll be right back.
It's here, the official Grok Radio mobile app. Listen to your favorite Grok Radio programs on your iPhone, iPad, iPod, Kindle Fire, Android smartphones, and tablets. The best thing is, it's absolutely free. Download it now from the iTunes or Google Play App Store, or get a link at our website, cyiworldwide.com. Grok Radio, Christian radio that doesn't suck.
And I'm Nick Peters, and we're back with Clinton Wilcox of the Life Training Institute, a staff apologist there. Our call in number is 714-242-5180, and our lines are open. Now, you talked about in your opening defense of a pro-life position how you make it about life being valuable. So let's look at that a little bit also with another situation. We have at our church a couple that my wife and I are friends with, and they have a little baby with Down syndrome. And the mother went to a secular hospital when she found out she was pregnant. They told her about it, and when they said this child would have Down syndrome, they said, you know, there are other options that you can take. They didn't come right out and say abortion, but she made it clear in the strongest terms possible, no, this is not going to happen. I'm not going to abort this child. I'm going to love and cherish her. But there are several people who would look and say, you know, someone with a severe disability of some sort, I mean, that's going to be a life of suffering. Why don't we just spare them from a life of suffering?
Yeah. That's kind of one of the tragedies of our culture, is we've kind of adopted this idea that if someone is going to have a difficult life, it would be better off for them to be dead. But I don't see how we can really make that observation. C. Everett Koop has written about disabled children, and he was pro-life, obviously, but he wrote about these children and said that being disabled and being unhappy do not necessarily go together. And now there are, I mean, you know, obviously there are some disabilities that are more debilitating than others. And Down syndrome is not a death sentence. There are a lot of Down syndrome children who grow up to do really marvelous things, and yet there's still a high statistic of unborn Down syndrome babies that are aborted. I think I don't have the studies on me, but from what I remember, I think about 90% of Down syndrome, of fetuses diagnosed with Down syndrome are aborted, and that's tragic. So I'm just not comfortable saying that someone would be better off dead to spare them from a difficult life. I think the more reasonable and rational thing to do is to get them out of that life, to do scientific studies to help overcome these ailments. And if someone is in just like a bad situation, like an abusive situation or poverty, I think we need to take steps to help them get out of that situation. I think that's a much better conclusion than simply killing someone, because we don't think they would want to grow up in that situation.
You know, I think it's worth mentioning at this point, and I goes along with that, that listeners of this podcast know that last week we had the podcast at a different time because my wife had an event Saturday, so we had Gresham Passantino come on Friday to about life being beautiful, and my wife was actually a part of the Miss Shining Star beauty pageant, where they had girls of various ages participating, all of them with disabilities. And I'll go ahead and state with, yes, some degree of pride, my wife won that pageant, by the way, and got crowned Miss Shining Star 2014. Yes, I am a very proud husband at this point. But when I'm sitting there watching this whole event, my mind's just thinking, and so many people would say, these little children have no right to live whatsoever. It was just devastating when I'm seeing all these disabled children, some with Down syndrome, some with various other disabilities up there, and some of them, they were very severe. I could imagine the parents go through a lot, but I'm pretty sure I can guess the reaction if anyone had gone up to any one of these parents and said, your child should have been aborted in the womb.
Yeah. In his book, Pro-Life Answers to Pro-Choice Questions, Randy Alcorn actually makes the point that it's kind of schizophrenic of our society because, we'll applaud special needs children in the Special Olympics, and we'll celebrate when someone with a disability does a great achievement, and yet before these people are born, we'll say, you should kill them so that they don't have to go through life like this. And I just can't fathom that. I mean, I can understand if someone is pro-choice because they make a logical argument, like the unborn are not persons or bodily rights or something like that. But if you're making the argument that someone should be killed because they have a disability, then you're not just saying that abortion should be legal because children have disabilities. It kind of seems like you're saying that people with disabilities, even outside the womb, shouldn't be alive. And I can't respect that position,
Yeah, and I say that with you as one who is, in fact, disabled. Listeners of the show know my wife and I are both Aspies, and I happen to have scoliosis as well, and I thoroughly enjoy my life. I'm very thankful to be alive. I want to enjoy it as long as I can. And I'm going to share from my personal experience what I've noticed, and maybe you've noticed the same thing too, Clinton, that when I meet children with severe disabilities and see them together with their parents, that many times some of these children are some of the happiest, most joyful children you meet. They're full of love. They love people. They want to be with people. And their parents will often tell me what a great joy this child is and how much they learn from that child. Do you find that in your experience too?
Absolutely, yeah. In fact, from what I understand, most people with disabilities, who have children with disabilities, they didn't realize this at first. And, oftentimes abortion can just kind of be a knee-jerk reaction, like, my child has a disability, what are we going to do? If someone pressures them into getting an abortion, they might get one in the emotional spur of the moment. But I think if you really step back and think about what that entails, then I think it's really not nearly as bad as you think it is, because a child is not going to grow up hating themselves if they're shown love. If the parents love the child, then the child will, at least this seems to me, I'm not a psychologist, obviously, but it seems to me that if the parents love the child, then regardless of the disability the child has, the child will grow up enjoying life, because having a disability is not, it's not the end of the world. It's not a death sentence. It may mean that they have to work harder at certain things, but if they're given the opportunities, then they'll take it.
Okay. Well, let's go on ahead then. So you've established that you get a human life. This life is something valuable. So let's go ahead and start making the case about this being a human life, because someone could say, well, this, what's in the womb, it's part of a woman's body.
Mm. Right. Once you make the biological case, that's just kind of the bare bones of the pro-life position. That's establishing that these are one of us biologically. So the next logical question is it a valuable entity? Is this something that it would be wrong to kill or something that it would be okay to kill? Now, a lot of people try to go the lack of personhood route, and that's another way to go. But sometimes someone tries to argue from bodily rights. And there's actually two different kinds of bodily rights arguments. Pro-life philosopher Trent Horn has illustrated these two differences. One is what we call the sovereign zone argument. And this just means that they're arguing basically that the woman's body is sacrosanct. It's a sovereign zone. She can do whatever she wants to anything with or inside her body. And the other is the right to refuse argument. And that's where a philosopher like Judith Jarvis Thompson would go with her violinist scenario. So when someone makes a bodily rights argument, it's pretty important to ask them a clarification question just to make sure you're accurately understanding where they're going and that you don't inadvertently strawman them, and a strawman being that you're attacking a similar argument but one that they're not actually holding. So if someone tries to make the case that that the child is a part of the woman's body, they're probably making the sovereign zone argument, like the woman, you know, the child is a part of her body, she can do whatever she wants to anything with or inside her body. But I think that's a very strong position to take, and one that's wholly indefensible. Because number one, if she can do anything she wants, anything within her body, then it seems like that would justify any sort of abortion that the woman wants. And there are some abortions that even most pro-choice people don't agree with. For example, most pro-choice people, and there have been Gallup poll studies that show this, that most people, including pro-choice people, oppose late-term abortions. And, you know, I've spoken to a lot of college students on campus, and most often it's just because, you know, it's kind of a psychological thing. Like, it's so close to being a baby, you know, it would just be really wrong to kill it. Whereas, you know, early on in pregnancy, it's just, you know, it's smaller than the period on a page, on a piece of paper. You know, there's like a psychological thing that goes along with that. And so most of them oppose late-term abortions, and I believe most also oppose sex selection abortions, that is, abortions just because the child is the wrong gender. So if we're going to argue that the woman can do anything she wants with anything in her body, then you would have to concede that even though there are some abortions you don't like, that it would not be wrong for the woman to have those abortions. You know, she has an abortion just because, you know, she wanted a boy, but she's getting a girl. Or she waits until, you know, like the week before, before her due date to have the abortion, those kinds of things. So if you're not willing to concede that, then it seems obvious that she can't just do anything that she wants with anything in her body. But if they do bite the bullet, and there's a couple other examples we can use. There's a drug back in the 50s and 60s called thalidomide. I believe Rich Papard is the one that we credit with this illustration. That drug, thalidomide, was meant to treat cancer, but it was discovered that drug also dealt with morning sickness in pregnant women. So doctors would start prescribing it to deal with their morning sickness. And so about 10 years or so down the road, it's discovered that thalidomide actually causes birth defects. Like, children would actually be born without arms and legs. And so doctors started taking it off the market. So if the woman has the right to do whatever she wants with anything in her body, then it seems like if she could procure thalidomide, for example, on the black market, that it would not be wrong for her to take that thalidomide to ease her morning sickness. You know, knowing full well that it will cause those birth defects. And so the question would be, do you think that it would be okay for her to take that thalidomide? And then if the answer is no, then again, she can't do anything she wants with anything in her body. But if she says yes, then forget the scenario about morning sickness. What if she takes it just because she wants to deform the child? Not kill the child, but deform the child. That's probably a very unlikely scenario, but that's irrelevant to the thought experiment. Just if she wanted to deform the child for whatever reason, you know, would she be justified in taking that thalidomide to deform the child? And I would imagine that most people who've stuck with me to this point will say no, because it seems like that would be wrong. So if she can't take thalidomide just to deform the child, then it seems like she can't do anything that she wants to do with anything inside her body. And then there's a couple other scenarios to go through, but for the most part, there's just certain things that we can't do with anything in our body, and that includes the unborn child. And so so if they're trying to make the argument that it's just a part of the woman's body, then it seems like we can't really defend that, because there are some things that she wouldn't be able to do to that child, like deform the child but not kill him and that kind of thing.
You know, we can also, in fact, say that we generally don't allow people to do anything they want with their bodies anyway. If someone wants to order, say, marijuana or cocaine or heroin or some illegal drug, we don't say, well, you can do that, I mean, just don't sell it to anyone else and such, just keep it to yourself. And at the same time also, we can say suicide can be an offense where punished people are for trying. Of course, you can't punish them if they succeed, but we'll put them in a mental institution for a few days, do something for them if someone tries to commit suicide, and it won't work. Say, where it's my body, I can do with it what I want.
Yeah, no, myself personally, I would probably avoid the suicide example just because I might encounter someone who actually believes that it should be legal to commit suicide because you're only harming yourself, not someone else. And so if I were going to use, you know, doing anything I want with my body, I would generally incorporate another person, you know, to avoid the harm to another person, to bring that back to abortion because there is another person that we're talking about. So that's just my personal view on that.
In fact, do we have some evidence to show that what's in the womb is technically not part of a woman's body?
For one thing, there's the law of transitivity, and the law of transitivity basically says if A is a part of C and B is a part of C, then if A is a part of C then and B is a part of C, then A is a part of B. So, for example, if your finger is a part of your hand and your hand is a part of your body, then your finger would be a part of your body. And so by the law of transitivity, if the unborn child were literally a part of her body like an appendage, then that would mean that every pregnant woman has four arms, four legs, 20 fingers, 20 toes, two heads, four eyes, two noses, and roughly half the time male genitalia. So just by the law of transitivity alone, we know that the child is not just a part of her body like an appendage, one of her arms or legs. But we also know that because the child has a different DNA signature than she does. The child's DNA is different than any other part of her body. And so that alone tells us that the child is not a part of her body, that it's a wholly separate entity.
Now, to be sure, that law is that if A is a part of B and B is a part of C, then A is a part of C, right?
Right, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, listen to
what
I...
We had to rephrasing it, so we'll make sure.
Right. I appreciate the correction.
Yeah, and as I think you said, what's in the womb has its own separate DNA code, doesn't it?
Right, yeah.
Well, we could get started with another point here now, but what we're going to do is just going to take another break, and we come back, we'll continue going with this line of argumentation. I'm Nick Peters of Deeper Waters Podcast. We'll be back after this break.
Check out CYIWorldwide.com. CYIWorldwide.com, home of Grok Radio. Free music downloads, advice, prayer, and support. CYIWorldwide.com. Do you grok?
Are you tired of the same old corporate Christian music on the radio? Check out Music Surge on Grok Radio, playing Christian music that doesn't suck. Download episodes now at CYIWorldwide.com.
And I am Nick Peters. This is the Deeper Waters Podcast. My guest is Clinton Wilcox, and he's here with us for the rest of the show. But if you're tuning in next week, we're going to have Dr. Frieda Busch. She's part of the ITAF conference from the Ruth Institute, led by Dr. Jennifer Roback Morris. She is a gynecologist, and she's going to be talking with us about the Medicare effects of abortion, how an abortion affects a woman medically. If that name sounds familiar, she was on our show earlier talking about the hookup culture, so she's going to be our first return guest. So I hope you all will be listening next week to Dr. Frieda Busch on. But for now, we've got Clinton Wilcox here, and we're talking about abortion, and is this something separate from the woman, in a sense? And there's another inconsistency with the law here, And we've talked about these inconsistencies before. For instance, in the famous case of, I think her name was Lacey Peterson, who was killed by her husband, that he killed her and her unborn baby, and he was charged with a double homicide. And so many people were saying, it's a shame he didn't just take her to an abortion clinic, or he could have avoided did one homicide charge.
Yeah. That's kind of my go-to example when I talk to people about the law, because there is a sort of schizophrenia when it comes to the law, because we allow the unborn child to die if the woman takes the child to an abortion practitioner and has the abortionist kill the child. But in many states, including my home state of California, the unborn child is seen as a person in the law, at least in the sense of an unwanted killing. It essentially boils down to, if the child is wanted, we treat them as a person. If the child is unwanted, we don't. Which, of course, is just really bad reasoning, but so the Lacey Peterson situation actually hits kind of close to home, because it happened around Visalia, which is actually about a 45-minute drive from me, and so that's the example that immediately springs to mind, and the one that I usually use. It's not the case in every state. For example, there was a recent shooting at a movie theater, I believe in Aurora, Colorado, in which a pregnant woman was shot and killed, and he was not tried for that second murder. So it's not every state that does this, but California is one of those states where if the child was wanted and you killed the unborn child, you are tried with a murder charge. And so Scott Peterson actually got a worse sentence because of that second murder charge, because of the unborn child that he killed.
Well, we've actually got two callers who have just called in here. I'm going to have to take them one at a time, but are you ready to take a call?
Sure.
Okay, for our first caller, you are on the air with Clinton Wilcox. What's
Hello?
Your question?
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. What's your question?
Hello? Oh, okay. I'm just curious about the killing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, atheists these days, you know, they're all pro-choice, whatever that means, you know, pro-murder. What is up with the atheist group, you know, with the atheist rising these days? I don't understand that.
I'm not familiar with the group in which you speak. I do know that being an atheist does not necessarily entail being pro-choice. I do know many pro-choice atheists, but I actually know many pro-life atheists, and there are a few groups that you can actually check out with the pro-life atheists, such as Secular Pro-Life, another group started by a friend of mine, Pro-Life Humanists, and you can find like a pro-life gay and lesbian group. Being atheist doesn't necessarily entail being pro-choice.
Yeah, but, you know, I these days, I notice these sites that have, you know, atheist, whatever, Satanist, you know, agenda, and they use grapes on the fetuses that had been aborted as a, you know, a way to sacrifice the fetus. Excuse me. So, and I don't know what to do. I want to go against them. I want to create a war. I want to create an army against grape atheists.
I'm not sure if I can, the best way, I'm not sure how to pose certain things like this, because there are certain issues that are really hard to pose, like human trafficking and things like that.
They call themselves the grapist. I mean, that's wrong, man. What are you going to do with that?
Well, I agree it's wrong. I'm just not sure what can be done to oppose that, other than just helping make abortion illegal again. Then we can get the law involved, that kind of thing.
Wait,
I'm not
abortion's
sure.
Legal?
Yeah.
You joke?
No. It's been
Where?
Legal for
when,
about 41
South
years
Africa?
Now. You're talking about abortion?
Yeah, abortion. Is that legal?
Yeah, it's legal here in America.
You mean in Africa?
Yeah.
Not America?
No, it's legal here in America.
You kidding me?
No.
No, wait, I don't believe it. You must be in the group. Are you an atheist?
No, I'm not an atheist. Sorry? Still there?
Yeah, we're going to be moving on from this. We're going to take our next caller, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, caller, you are on the air with Clinton Wilcox.
Hey, yo, can you hear me good?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, cool. What's good, Clinton? You cool?
Yeah.
Okay, so I got a little situation. My girl, Leticia. She the pregnant, she my side hold though. I mean, she not my main girl, but anyway, she the impregnation, she don't want to get an abortion, but I'm not looking to be a father. I just wondering what you can do to help me out. You know, is there a set of stairs near here, or what can I do to go about this? Because, you know, I'm still young, man. I'm 21. I mean, I've been to prison twice. I can't be a father, man. I need help.
Well, I mean, there's nothing I can really say about that. I mean, if she doesn't, you know, she doesn't want to have the abortion, then, you know, that's her decision. The law recognizes that she's going to have it alone.
Okay, is there no programs I can go through? I mean, she not cool, though. I mean, I had two toes. I mean, they used to battle each other. They were the battle toads, and she killed them. She's so pissed because she not my main girl. She found out I was with another guy, I'm the homosexual, you know? I mean, I don't really like girls, but anyway, drunken night out, a lot of molly, a lot of drinking, and this is what happens, man. I mean, I don't know what to do. She's 3 months gone. I just need help right now, man.
What I would probably recommend is maybe finding a pregnancy care center in nearby. They offer help with these kinds of situations.
Okay, and do these cost the dollars? You know, I mean, I'm the hardworking man, but I'm not looking to spend extra dollars if there's a cheaper way to go about here, if you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
you know, kind of like DIY, do it yourself.
This is why, you know, we need to be held responsible for our actions, because, you know, if we can't afford children, then we need to be more careful with our sexual exploits.
I mean, you know? It's in the nature. I mean, we all animals. I mean, in our nature, with to find the female and give her that ooh ooh ooh. Know what I'm saying?
Well, yeah, but this is the kind of thing that sets us. I'm sorry.
Yeah, we need to be wrapping this one up again, so can you just stay
okay, I don't want to take too much of your time, man. It's just my whole future ahead of me. No biggie.
Yeah, I would just say, find a pregnancy care center. They can help with this kind of situation.
Pregnancy care center. Okay, yeah. Okay. That's cool, man. Well, thanks for your help today, and I hope you have a good life. I mean, I hope I'm not going to be a father, but... Hey, shit, man, if I am, I'm going to get a good kid, get him slanging on the street corners with me. I got that Molly, 3 for $10. Holler at your boy,
Yeah, kind of thing, we're getting a lot of less than your cars today. And one thing I would say before we go to our next caller is that if someone winds up being pregnant, there's already a mother and a father. The question that we need to ask people, I think, sometimes is, you want to be the mother and father of a dead child or a living child?
Right.
So, let's take our next caller here. And you're on the air with Clinton Wilcox.
Hello. Hey, Tom here. I've been listening to your show for a few minutes now, maybe about 15 or so. Personally, I'm pro-choice, and I know it may sound bad, but that's my personal view, and... And I think part of the reason is that you know, sometimes having a child when you don't really, you know, need to have one or can't afford it, I mean, it's better not to have the child if you can't afford it, you know? And when I had a girl, I'd gotten her pregnant, and basically, you know, so we went to the abortion clinic, and, you know, I mean, it was a hard thing. You know, when she came out crying, and I'm sitting there thinking, well, she was all for him, like, you know, asked her what was wrong. She said, oh, well, you know, I locked myself out of my car, so I had to, you know, she had to go back in and ask the clinic for a coat hanger. So, you know, and that's hard. I mean, because, you know, of all the jokes and about the stairs, you know, pushing down the stairs and all that. I mean, you've heard of, like, penny royalty and all that, and that only works early. You really got to, like, dose hard on it to kill the kid, you know, because they're expensive. And, you know, I mean, I guess, you know, I've heard of people punching them in the stomach or smacking them in the vag, you know, that kind of thing. Sometimes that doesn't work, and you end up with a retard. So, you know, and no one wants to raise a retard. I mean, they always say that they love their kids, but it's bull, because they're like, you know, look at this, the kid's deformed, you know, and then it's too late to put him down, because then it's murder. And I think that there should be a law where, you know, within a certain, maybe 2 years or something, if you see something's funky with the kid's eye or something like that, you know, you should be able to put them down, you know, lawfully, so to avoid, you know, gene mutations for further generations. That's kind of, you know, my personal opinion on it. You know, I guess there's probably not a lot of people that share that opinion, and I really don't consider it murder. I mean, they don't even remember the first 5 years of their life. I mean, you just give them a lollipop, and they're down, you know. So I just kind of wanted to chime in and let you know that's kind of my opinion on it, and have a nice day.
Yeah, this seems to be exactly what we were talking about earlier here. What do you think of what our last caller was saying here?
I kind of would have liked... is he gone or is he still on the line?
Yes, he hung up.
Okay, I kind of would have liked him to stick around so I could ask him a few questions. Because, I mean, the first thing I would ask is, what is it that makes us valuable? You know, he's talking about killing deformed children. Well, you know, how? I mean, I hesitate to use the word because I don't want to be offensive to people with disabilities. But like how, I guess, non-disabled does one have to be before we can keep you around? You know, I think a lot of us have certain issues. I mean, you know, no one is absolutely perfect in their physical, physical bodies. You know, we have aches and pains and bad backs and, you know, bad knees and things like that. So, you know, how perfect does one need to be before one can guarantee that we'll keep them around, basically?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you've got someone here who's disabled right now, and I'm not taking any offense whatsoever. To what's been
said. Yeah, I was trying to choose my words carefully.
Yeah. Right. I think some of that also was from that was that the idea of unwanted children, supposedly. Yeah. And this is a great myth that a lot of pro-lifers have spoken about. And the truth is, there are no unwanted children, are there?
Right. Yeah. Right, yeah, because, you know, every child is wanted by somebody. I mean, there are waiting lists to adopt disabled children. You know, every child is wanted by somebody. And I've often heard pro-life people say that that calling a child unwanted says more about the person who doesn't want it than about the child. You know?
And I understand, in fact, that you can have a harder time adopting a child here in America because of the abortion industry. That's why so many adoptive parents are going to other countries to adopt children.
Well, right. That's exactly right. We're aborting most of the children that would be adopted. So there's actually a lot more people waiting to adopt than there are children to adopt.
Mm-hmm. And something else that was brought out, it was financial security. A lot of these people do want financial security when they get caught in a bind. Again, adoption does help take care of that, doesn't it?
It does, and that's also why we need to be more responsible about our sexual choices. You know, that's come about from divorcing sex from its procreative function is that now people want to have the sex recreatively, and then, you know, they have a child, which, you know, seems to come as a surprise to many people, even though sex leads to pregnancy. So then they'll find themselves in a bind because they can't afford a child or whatever. But, you know, we can't allow people to kill children just because they can't afford them. I mean, you know, trot out the toddler again. Would we allow a mother of a 2-year-old child to kill her toddler because she just lost her job and can't afford it? Well, no, we wouldn't. The child is a human child, and if the unborn child is fully human like you and me, then we can't justify killing it for that reason either. So, you know, if you can't afford a child, you need to be more responsible about having sex in the first place. At least that's what it seems to me.
But if someone is irresponsible and does get themselves in these kinds of binds, that is why crisis pregnancy centers exist, and they don't really charge for what they do, do they?
To the best of my knowledge, they don't. They offer a lot of services and don't charge for them. They also offer services to single mothers, like with free diapers and free car seats. They'll give them for free, but my understanding is that you have to go through a parenting class, which isn't a big deal because that's beneficial to the parent as well. So you do have to go through a parenting class, and then they'll give you credit toward something in their, something toward what, you know, helps them through their single parenthood or their pregnancy, that kind of thing. So you'll go through parenting classes as well. But pregnancy care centers are there specifically to help mothers and fathers through these pregnancies. And they do, not only do they offer them alternatives to abortion, which the abortion clinic won't offer, but they also build relationships with these people as well, which is very important.
And there was an idea that I've used before, and I like to kind of bounce off of you and see if you think about this, is I've had people make a list before when discussing about reasons, and when I teach pro-life positions, that here are reasons why some people will get an abortion. They don't want their career to be held back, they want financial stability, they want to be able to enjoy sex. There are so many reasons, they don't think they're mature enough, etc. So, you know, when we look at these reasons, most of us would look at these reasons for wanting an abortion and say, the things that they want are not necessarily evil in themselves. There's nothing wrong with wanting financial stability. There's nothing wrong with wanting to enjoy sex. There's nothing wrong with wanting to advance your career. But the question we have to ask is, are you really taking a good means to get that end or not?
Right. Yeah. Because in fact, that's another reason that abortion is wrong, is because it's because it treats children as means to an end instead of an end in themselves. Mm-hmm. Because now, you know, if you, like I said, there's nothing wrong with enjoying sex. There's nothing wrong with wanting financial stability, those kinds of things. But if you have to kill somebody to attain those ends, then you're doing something wrong. And so it's all about how you go about obtaining those ends.
Well, we're coming up on our next commercial break, so we're going to take that here. I'm Nick Peters, the Deeper Waters Institute podcast. We'll be back after this break.
Hey, this is Minister Grock. Thanks for listening. Although Grock Radio is free, there are costs to upkeep the website, podcast, and purchase Bibles and materials for street ministry. And while we are happy to pay this ourselves out of pocket, we will gladly accept any gift if you feel led to support the shows and our street ministry. You can send a gift or love offering through our website at cyiworldwide.com. Thanks for your support, and God bless.
And I'm back with Kenton Wilcox of the Life Training Institute. And I'd like to remind everyone in our donations that, yes, everything we do here is listener support. As I've said numerous times, I don't get a single penny for what I do here. And yet everything I do is volunteer. I didn't pay Clinton anything. Come on, he came on volunteer entirely. So if you want to support Blog Talk Radio, please do so. We need your help. And if you want to support Deeper Waters personally, you can go to my blog at deeperwaters.wordpress.com. Or you can make donations for me through a ministry like, say, the Risen Jesus Ministry. That's the ministry of Mike Sacona. Or you can even go for the Ratio Christi Issues and Answers. And how about you? Do you take donations as a staff apologist? And if not, how about Life Training Institute? I mean, how do people make donations to support what you're doing?
Okay, yeah, I do take donations because I'm a full-time pro-life advocate, and so I subsist on raising support from generous donors. And if someone would like to help me in that, they can just go to my personal website, which I've recently created. It's just www.clintonwilcox.com. Or if they'd like to donate to Life Training Institute generally, because they do a lot of great things. They send apologists to numerous places to speak to high school kids and to college students, and you can donate to them through their website, which is prolifetraining.com or .org, one of the two. You should try them both. I think it's .org.
Now, one aspect of the pro-life case that we need to get on, since we're going to talk about the Life Training Institute, it's a favor of Scott Klusendorf's, and that's SLED. What is SLED?
Okay, well, once you've established that the unborn are biologically one of us, the next logical question is, are those unborn entities the kind of thing that we can kill? Now, the SLED test was developed by Stephen Schwartz in a book called The Moral Question of Abortion. And it basically argues that there are four main differences between us and the unborn. Size, that they're a lot smaller than we are. Level of development, they're a lot less developed than we are. Environment, they're differently located than we are. They're in the womb, we're outside the womb. And then degree of dependency, that they're a lot more dependent than we are, because they're dependent on the mother's body for survival. And so the SLED test is, size, level of development, environment, degree of dependency, make the acronym SLED. It makes it easier to remember. And so the SLED test is just meant to show us that there are four main differences between us and them, but those four main differences are not morally relevant to where we can justify killing the unborn, but not kill us. And so that's what it's meant to do. And so if pro-choice people want to justify killing them through the act of abortion, they have to find some kind of morally relevant difference between them and us that would justify killing them, but not justify killing us or anyone that we call, kind of the non-controversial people with the right to life.
Now, we've talked about these before, and one of the things we wanted to get to as well was Peter Singer's idea, which involved personhood, because some people were looking to say, well, this, what's in the womb, it's fully human, okay, but it's not a person. I mean, what are we supposed to make of that?
The first question would be, obviously, I know approximately what Peter's saying would say, but if I'm talking to someone that I've never met before, my first question would be, okay, so what is the relevant characteristic for you? What do you believe bestows personhood? So if we want to take, many different philosophers have basically offered their own suggestions as to what actually makes us persons. Someone like Peter Singer would say, well, it's self-awareness. It's seeing yourself as an entity that persists through time. Self-awareness is a property that bestows on us personhood and value, because if you don't see yourself as persisting through time, then it doesn't really seem like it's a harm to kill you, because you don't know you're being killed, and you don't have any plans or desires or anything that we're thwarting by killing you. So it really doesn't seem like we're doing anything wrong by killing you, because we're not thwarting your desire to live or your plans for the future or anything like that.
And that seems to get into kind of like what our last caller was talking about with, I was saying that we don't have any memories until we're five or so, which I personally thought was nonsense.
Right.
I can remember things when I was 3 or 4 years old, for instance, very well.
Right.
But what do you say this, when someone says, well, you know, you don't have desires, you don't have a self-awareness, so you're not a person yet, so it's okay.
Right. So, so my thought is that you don't really have to be I'll tackle this in a couple of steps. First, about knowing that you're being harmed, and then about the self-awareness. But for one thing, you don't have to know that you're being harmed in order to be harmed. A pretty obvious example of this would be if a man cheats on his wife, but she never finds out. Has she been harmed? Well, I would say, yeah, she's been harmed. Some pro-life philosophers use the example. Suppose Jennifer Aniston is in a coma. She'll come out of it, but the doctor takes sexual advantage of her while she's in that coma. He's in a room by himself. She'll never find out, but has she still been harmed? Well, yeah, of course she has. Another example I've heard is suppose there's a child whose rich uncle dies, to where he's going to get an inheritance once he gets old enough, but the person in charge of him basically makes off with the inheritance. If a child never finds out that his inheritance was stolen from him, has he been harmed? Well, yes, of course he has. So it really seems like one does not have to be aware of being harmed to be harmed. So arguing that that they're not aware of being harmed, it seems like it doesn't justify killing them.
Yeah, another example that I've seen used is children with a condition such as SEPA, that they are incapable of feeling pain. You could cut a finger off of them and they never know it had happened. Their parents have to check them every single day to make sure that nothing's happened to them.
Yeah, in fact, there is an example of this that I point to. There's a girl named Gabby Gingras who was born with a congenital inability to feel pain. If you're talking about whether somebody can feel pain, then obviously Gabby Gingras wouldn't qualify as a person because she can't feel pain. She's born with that congenital inability. Frank Beckwith, regarding the self-awareness again, I believe it's Beckwith, came up with an experiment, a thought experiment, to talk about self-awareness. For example, let's say that there are two children. One is born normal, grows to the point where he becomes self-aware, and then lapses into a coma, which he won't come out of for about 9 months. And then a child is born in a coma and won't come out of it for a year or two. If someone is going to argue that you must be presently self-aware, then it seems like the child who attains self-awareness but lapsed into a coma would be a person, but the second child who was born in a coma would not be a person, even after they have advanced to the point where they would become self-aware. They still would not be a person until they come out of the coma. So it seems like self-awareness can lead to some pretty absurd conclusions regarding who we can kill and who we can't kill. It seems to go against our strong intuitions about who we should consider valuable.
It looks like we've got a couple callers here, and we can take them if you want, and if I don't think they're legit, then I'll take care of that. But you want to take some callers?
I'll leave that to your discretion.
Okay. Caller, you're on the air of Clinton Wilcox.
Hello?
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 Do you have a question?
Hello?
Yeah, can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Alright, so I got this problem with my girlfriend, right? And, you know, she's pregnant, right?
Yeah.
And we like to get kinky sometimes, and one night things were getting particularly saucy, right? And, you know, I'm sticking my noodle in her when I notice she's...
Okay. Carlo, you're on the air. Hello? Yeah, it's quite disturbing, though. Some people have nothing better to do with their time here. Let's get back to what we were talking about here. One idea you brought up also was that of Judith Jarvis Thompson. Now, I know the argument she makes. I'm quite sure you know it better than I do, though. So, can you tell us what Judith Jarvis Thompson's argument was?
Sure. This gets into the second type of bodily rights argument that I alluded to earlier. We talked about the sovereign zone argument. This gets into the right to refuse argument. And it's a bit science fiction-y because this probably couldn't happen in real life, but the thought experiment essentially goes like this. There's a famous violinist who is stuck in a hospital room dying of a fatal kidney ailment. You wake up in that same hospital room, attached by the kidney to that famous violinist. The doctor bursts into the room and says, "Oh, thank goodness you're awake. I'm terribly sorry about this, but this world famous violinist has a kidney ailment, and you were the only match for this kidney. The Society of Music Lovers kidnapped you, brought you in here, and plugged you into the violinist, and here you must remain for 9 months in order for this violinist to get better. I'm sorry, I can't unplug you because that would kill the violinist, and he has a right to life." And so you can kind of see how this, how she's trying to draw a parallel to pregnancy here. And so her argument is, that if you might be morally obligated to stay plugged in, or you might not. It might just be morally heroic. But even if you are morally obligated to stay plugged into that violinist, you should not be legally compelled to stay plugged in. And that is Thompson's argument in a nutshell.
I think I've heard an account that there was one pro-life apologist, pretty prominent one. I don't remember who it was, but he said he was driving when he first heard this argument, and he nearly crashed because it really is such a powerful argument.
Yeah, I believe that was Greg Kokel who wrote that in an article.
Okay, so yeah, this is a powerful argument, and Greg Kokel was one of the best, and I'm starting this bit flunked, but I mean, he no longer is, but a lot of people out there are listening and saying, that sounds good, but I mean, I'm not sure how I could respond to that. So how is it that we respond to this?
Okay. Well, the reason that this argument is so powerful is because she's trying to assume the major premise of the pro-life argument, that the unborn are just as human and just as valuable as we are. And she's conceding that premise and arguing that we can kill them anyway. And that's what makes the argument so powerful. So there are actually numerous responses we can give to this. Some are not as good, and some are better than that. I'm sorry? Yeah.
I didn't say anything. I've just been listening.
Oh. Okay, sorry. I thought I heard you talking. There actually might be a little bit of an echo with my cell phone, so I might actually be hearing myself echo, so I apologize about that. So this argument concedes the major premise of the pro-life position. So there are some responses to this, some that are not quite as good, but and some that are better. One of the responses is that you don't know the violinist. You're a stranger to the violinist. But in the case of pregnancy, that is your biological child. And it seems like we have obligations to our children that we don't have to strangers. Now, I find this to be a compelling response, but one might also change the example to say, okay, it's not a famous violinist, but it's your long-lost son. Despite the fact that you've never built any ties, never raised him, would you still be obligated, should you still be legally compelled to stay plugged in? Or would you still be morally obligated to? So some people would probably say no, just because it's an estranged son. So they might be able to respond that the biological connection isn't enough to justify the moral obligation. Another response is that in the violinist case, you're merely unplugging, whereas in the case of abortion, it's a direct act of killing. So instead of unplugging, it would be more like you're hacking the violinist to pieces in order to unplug from him. And so that response works, except that there are some forms of abortion, like RU486, which are more literally like unplugging the unborn child. You take the pill, and it basically disconnects the unborn child, and the child ends up starving to death. So that would so that response works against surgical abortions. I'm sorry?
Whenever aspect of it, that's...
Right, yeah, it works against surgical abortion. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm sorry, it must be my computer connection here, but I think whenever aspect of it, as wherever it's often brought out, is that what's happened in the case of our Linus is an involuntary action, whereas having sex is usually, yes, we know the cases of rape, but usually it's a very voluntary action.
Right, and so, yeah, so whereas the unplugging versus direct killing doesn't oppose all forms of abortion, just the surgical ones, the best response is that in the case of the violinist, you're an unwilling party, whereas in the case of consensual sex, the woman and the man engage in an act willingly that leads to the pregnancy. And so you not only bear a responsibility for the child's existence, but you bear a responsibility for putting the child in a naturally needy condition, whereas in the violinist scenario, you're not responsible for the condition that the violinist finds himself in. So the responsibility objection is really the one that does away with the violinist scenario.
And sometimes people will say, well, I consented to sex, but I did not consent to getting pregnant.
Yeah, that's one I hear pretty frequently online. I don't hear it so much in person. That argument was put forth by a pro-choice philosopher named Eileen McDonough, who was basically trying to argue that a woman consents to sex but does not consent to the pregnancy. She's not the cause of pregnancy. It's the fetus that is the cause of pregnancy. And so because of that, she is neither responsible, number one, she's not responsible for her pregnancy, but number two, since the fetus is basically an aggressor, the state has an obligation to pay for its removal. So it was kind of a dual argument, arguing for the moral and legal permissibility of abortion and also arguing that the state is obligated to pay for them, basically.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, we can...
Yeah.
In fact, often say that if you open yourself up to an act, there are consequences of that act, then you are opening yourself up to those. It won't work to, if you get an STD, for instance, to say, well, I didn't consent to an STD. Well, the truth is, you've got one now anyway.
Right, yeah. The way that Scott Klusendorf responds to this in his book, The Case for Life, is he says that, and he might be quoting someone else, I'm not sure if this is his or another pro-life advocate's, but he basically said that you can consent to an act, but you can't consent to the consequences of an act. So, for example, you can consent to surgery, but you can't consent to a successful surgery. You can consent to play the lottery, but you can't consent to win the lottery. That's because the success of the surgery and winning the lottery are factors outside of your control. Just like pregnancy is, you can even though you're responsible for the sex act, you commit that sex act knowing full well that sex leads to pregnancy. Even though it's the act of sex that created the human zygote that implants itself in the woman's womb, that zygote would not even exist if it were not for the woman and the man who had sexual relations in the first place.
We're going to take our final break, and we'll be back with Clinton Wilcox soon. I'm Nick Peters, the Deeper Waters Podcast. We'll be back after this break.
Oh, yeah. Hey, folks, it's Will ZPI.
And you guys gotta check out CYIWorldwide.com, home of the Grok Show. Free MP3s, music, advice, and even prayer support. That again is CYIWorldwide.com. Check it out.
And I'm Nick Peters of the Deeper Waters Podcast. My guest is Clinton Wilcox of the Life Training Institute. We're talking about making a pro-life case. And, you know, something else that I think should be brought out, since this is a Christian show, is that usually we're told, for instance, that God or nature, for instance, can be the biggest abortionist out there, because so many pregnancies end in miscarriage. So if that's
right.
the case, what can be the big deal about us having an abortion?
Okay, yeah, this is an argument that I hear occasionally. Just the first thing that seems pretty obvious, at least from my view, as a conservative Bible-believing Christian, is that just because God does something does not give us license to do it. You know, because God is the giver of life, He's the one who can take it away. So, so just because there are cases of God enacting divine judgment in the Old Testament, or even in the New Testament with Priscilla and Aquila.
Ananias and Sapphira, I think you're talking about, right?
Ananias and Sapphira, yes, thank you. So just because God takes life in the Bible does not justify our doing so. But second of all, the number of miscarriages, it's not clear exactly how many of those are actual legitimate human beings, because not everything that results from the sperm and the egg fusing, not everything that results from that is a human being. Sometimes you get like a molar pregnancy or some other non-human entity. And these are often, not always, but they're often fleshed out with the woman's menstrual cycle. And so a lot of these, quote-unquote miscarriages that pro-choice people talk about, a lot of those are not legitimate human beings. So you'll hear figures like 50% of all pregnancies are fleshed out, but that's a dubious claim because I don't know if these studies actually show that they're just talking about human beings or if they're talking about anything that results from the fusion of sperm and egg, which is not always a human being. So the numbers are probably not as high as pro-choice people would have us believe. But on top of that, the fact that people die naturally does not justify our taking their lives intentionally. People die of natural causes, but that doesn't justify murder. My friend Josh Baum has said a mass amount of people die in natural disasters, but that doesn't justify us nuking cities. So just the fact alone that human beings die naturally does not justify our taking their lives intentionally.
Well, you brought up numbers, and since we're getting to a point where we're going to be some things up, let's talk about numbers. This is something I talked with you about a week or so before the show came on, is that are the numbers in our favor more nowadays with more and more people being pro-life?
Right. Yeah, the argument is usually made that the numbers do show that the young generation now is actually the most pro-life generation, more pro-life than their parents' generation. I know Secular Pro-Life wrote an article about that this past Monday, which is basically a collection of all the findings. And it seems like pro-abortion organizations like NARAL actually understand that and agree with it too, because they're trying hard to try and recruit more people into the pro-choice side of the arena. And so it seems like we are more pro-life, and that's because the pro-life people, number one, we have more to gain from winning, because there are 3,300 lives at stake every day. But number two, we have the harder fight, because we're fighting to get abortion made illegal again. So we're basically fighting against the status quo, which means that pro-life people have to put up more of a fight. And the pro-choice organizations like NARAL, Planned Parenthood, they get government funding to work to kill unborn children. And pro-life people basically subsist and survive off of generous donors because, you know, they don't get any government grants at all, which is why it's so important for people who don't feel called to be a pro-life advocate like I am, or like Scott Klusendorf or Josh Brom or any of these other guys. If someone doesn't feel called to be a pro-life advocate, it's very important that that they do you know, donate financially to these pro-life organizations, because, you know, every dollar counts, you know, whether it be to help fund the pro-life advocates that are helping to change hearts and minds, or to fund the pregnancy care centers that are able to offer these free services to pregnant women and single mothers and fathers, or, you know, any of these other organizations that are working to save unborn children. As I hear Scott Klusendorf say, there are more people working full-time to kill unborn children than there are working to save them. So you know, every little bit counts.
You know, one other reason I think that the pro-life side could be growing in numbers actually is that we breed a whole lot more than the other side does. We actually
right.
have children that we can raise up and teach the pro-life message to instead of killing off our children.
Yeah, that could be part of it. I don't know if I would necessarily make that argument, just because, you know, there's a lot of psychology that goes into abortion, and there are pro-life people that have abortions, because when they, you know, when a young girl finds herself pregnant, she might be philosophically pro-life, but she might be, you know, really scared about certain things in her life, and it's that emotional thing that draws her into having it. And so I think that there is the point that we are having more children, and we are training them to be pro-life, but I'm not sure I can say how big of an impact it has is the only thing.
Now, a lot of people though do say that Roe v. Wade is the law of the land. That's not going to change. What do you think? And what do you think at LTI? You think that we really can change the law of the land? Can we reverse the trend of abortion?
Yeah, the only thing I can say to that is, you know, slavery used to be the law of the land. There used to be a big fight between, you know, the pro-slavery and the slavery abolitionists. And the argument was made, you know, slavery is the law of the land. You know, if you oppose slavery, don't own slaves. You know, my plantation, my choice. These are arguments that you would hear from the pro-slavery side, and yet that didn't stop the slavery abolitionists from recognizing that slavery is a moral evil, and that we should fight for the freedom of all human beings, whether they be black, white, male, female, you know, gay, straight, whatever. All human beings have basic human rights, and to enslave them, or to bring it more to the modern times, to kill them because they're in the way of something we want is just the height of immorality. I mean, if that's not wrong, I mean, nothing's wrong, you know. So just because it's the law of the land doesn't mean that it can't be overturned. We need to do what the anti-slavery crowd did before us and change hearts and minds on the issue. And that's what organizations like LTI, Justice for All, and other pro-life organizations, that's what they're setting out to do, to change hearts and minds on people, to get them more motivated to speak out against abortion, and to change the general attitude toward abortion so that we can see legalized abortion come to an end in our lifetimes.
So do you think, though, that this is, and that we can say is a reasonable goal, that, say, within a generation's time, we could undo Roe v. Wade and make abortion illegal again?
To be honest, I'm not sure if it will be done in my generation. I would love for it to be done in my generation, and I'm going to continue to speak out against it as long as I'm drawing breath. I would love for that to happen. I don't know if I can really say it'll happen within a generation, but I think definitely within a couple of generations we will see an end. And if I have anything to do with it, or any of my colleagues have anything to do with it, then we will see an end to it in a couple of decades.
We talked about donating before, and donating is a great way to support the pro-life movement. Let's suppose someone is out there and they're saying, I want to do a little bit more, but I'm not exactly sure how to get started, what to do exactly. How would you recommend people can go about doing further to support the pro-life cause other than just donating?
I would say probably the most important thing is, number one, to educate yourself. If you see a pro-life speaker or event or something in your neighborhood,
okay, something has happened with him. He seems to have lost the call here, and so I'll be filling in until he happens to call back. But for those of you out there who are wondering, the Life Training Institute does have various people that can come and speak at your church or Christian organization, or even in, if the case may be, your secular pro-life organization, that can help you make the case for life. And I would certainly hope that you would take advantage of that pro-life case. And also, you can go out to places like your local abortion clinics, places like that, and volunteer your services. Stand out there, be peaceful, of course, follow the law of the land, but go out there and speak people, talk to them, and there are several good organizations that you can work with in this regard who will team up with you and help you see the best way that you can go about this. And go out, do blogging as well. One of my really good friends consistently blogs on a pro-life position. Use the social media to your advantage and get the pro-life viewpoint out there. If you're going to change it, it's going to be changed by your actions as well, by you getting out there, by you getting the message out there and letting people know you are pro-life, that this is where you stand, and that you're ready to defend it. Now, I am working to get Clinton back here. He was on his cell phone. I don't know if his cell phone just died or what, but hopefully we can get him back. If not, you know, it was certainly great to have him on here. And I really do hope you're going to be here next week as well. Next week, we're going to have Frieda Bush coming on. She worked with Ina. Okay, Clinton's back here. So.
Clinton. Sorry about that, Mike. Sorry about that. My cell phone died on me and didn't warn me it was about to die, so I've got to plug it in.
Okay. Now, you were talking about what you can do to support the pro-life cause. Now, I was mentioning to people that they can be out there blogging, they can use social media, they can go to, say, abortion clinics and have a peaceful protest, you know, and maybe you could even give some tips on how they could better do those kinds of things.
Right. In fact, blogging is actually a pretty important one. I mean, blogging is actually partially how I got noticed by pro-life people. So if you blog, that can be a great way to get your own thoughts out there and to help educate others on the pro-life cause. On top of that, they have 40 Days for Life, which is an event in where they go to the local Planned Parenthood, and you know it's really a Christian thing because they do a lot of prayer at the abortion clinics. But you can get involved with 40 Days for Life, or even if you're not a Christian if you are a Christian but want to get something started, you can just have like a peaceful vigil in front of an abortion clinic, things like that. So yeah, there's numerous things. Volunteering at a local pregnancy care center would be a really good thing also. There's a lot of things that someone can do who wants to get more involved in the abortion issue.
And one thing I've said, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, but you can get in touch with the Life Training Institute about having an apologist like yourself come to their church or Christian organization or maybe even secular pro-life organization and make the case for life, right?
Yeah. This is what Life Training Institute does. So by all means, you go to their website and request a speaker. Life Training Institute has some of the best speakers in the nation. And so, that's definitely a good thing. And you'll likely get a really good turnout for that as well.
Now, we've only got about 5 minutes left. I'd like to remind people, as I just said while ago, that Dr. Frieda Busch of the ITAF conference is going to be our guest next week. She's medical doctor in the field. She's going to be talking about the medical aspects of abortion. And, some of you might want to have like a listener discretion advice if you got small children there, because we could get in some pretty graphic stuff in that case. But that's going to be next week. So you've only got about a little less than 5 minutes left. And what's the final message you would like to leave with our audience?
Probably just that, with the numbers behind us, the most pro-life generation that we have getting involved in the abortion issue, and the fact that we have really, organizations like Life Training Institute, Justice for All, and organizations that are helping to change hearts and minds on the issue, and really smart apologists like Frank Beckwith and Christopher Texor, and everyone else that's on the front lines. The reason that I am pro-life now is not just because of my Christian faith, but it's also because I believe that the best arguments are on the pro-life side, that the unborn are valuable human beings, and that it's wrong to kill valuable human beings, and so that abortion is wrong. And so we have the best arguments on our side, which is why education is very important, learning the good arguments and avoiding the bad ones, and having good conversations with people, avoiding the name-calling, avoiding the inflammatory inflammatory terms like pro-abort or things like that, to treat the other side with respect, because that's the best way to get them to listen to you. And if we keep doing what we're doing, united in the pro-life cause and keeping the good arguments going, then we will see an end to legalized abortion in the United States. And that's something that I'm hopeful for, and that's something that I truly believe. And I think that the fight is worth it, and it's one of the most important ones that we can be involved in right now.
Now, if people want to find out more about you, they can go to ClintonWilcox.com, right?
Yeah, or my blog at prolifephilosophy.blogspot.com.
Now, Clinton Wilcox, that's CLINTONWILCOX.
Right.
And what if they want to find out more about the Life Training Institute?
You can go to the website, prolifetraining.org.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it's .org. It might be .com, but I'm pretty sure it's .org.
Well, Clinton, I'd like to thank you with just a couple minutes left. I'd like to thank you for being my guest today on the Deeper Waters podcast. I hope you've enjoyed your time, and hopefully sometime in the future we'll even see you back here again.
Oh, definitely. I'm honored that you've had me on to talk about this, so I thank you for letting me be here.
No problem. And so I'd like to remind people that Clinton, I think, is someone that you definitely want to be watching in the pro-life movement. We've got several coming up in the ranks in apologetics, and just keep an eye on them, support them, do what you can to help them out. And for now, I'm Nick Peters from the Deeper Waters podcast. Remember, next week, Dr. Frieda Busch talking about abortion in the medical aspect. For now, I'm signing off, and I will see you next Saturday.